So good afternoon. I am Lisa Furniture, and I will be your mediator this evening.
Hi.
And you are?
Samantha.
Okay, and Samantha, do you mind if I call you Samantha, or do you prefer Miss?
Samantha's
last name. Okay. And you are?
Matt.
Okay, Matt, nice to meet you. And same with you. Do you?
Yeah, Matt.
Matt's okay? Okay, great. So this meeting was scheduled today to help you resolve the issues that brought you here. I also want to thank you and commend you for being here today. Being that it is a voluntary process, it does show commitment in resolving your issues. And so I would like to explain to you my role as a mediator and also a little bit more about the process. So as a mediator, I am not a judge, and I will not be deciding, I will not be taking sides of who is right or wrong. I am simply a neutral and impartial third party who remains unbiased. I would also like to mention that if I nod my head throughout the session, or smile, or maybe say something that says, oh great, or you know, that sounds great, good, that does not mean that I am necessarily agreeing with you one way or the other. That's just simply means that I'm acknowledging and following what it is that you are saying to me. As this process is one that I will guide you through by asking you several questions about the situation and assist in developing mutually satisfying solutions. I will be keeping all information that we discuss here today confidential. Any notes that you see me take throughout the process, I assure you they will be shredded at the end of the session. Only the agreement to mediate and the final agreement will be kept on file. With that being said, that there are a few instances where I may have to break that confidentiality. And that would be in the instance that if one or both of you indicate a threat to yourself or to one another, in which I feel the threat will be acted upon, or also if you disclose any information regarding child abuse, then I am, of course, obligated to report any of this information to the authorities. And then also, if there is ever a chance that I am subpoenaed to testify or provide documents by order of the court, you both will be notified immediately. Okay. Additionally, there are there may be times that I may ask you to speak with either one of you like separately, and where I will ask one of you to step out of the room while I speak with the other, and vice versa. So this may be so that I can clarify any information that you have shared with me that you may not feel as comfortable sharing around the other party, at least initially. And please know that the confidentiality still does apply, you know, throughout this. Unless, of course, that is if you would prefer me to, you know, share it openly with the other party. And so as we continue here, I would like to ask if both of you have the necessary authority to decide on how this matter can be resolved.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Good deal. So before we do get to sharing our perspectives, I would like to discuss some ground rules with you that I ask that both of you agree with. The first one would be that only one person speak at a time. While one is speaking, the other one can listen respectfully. And I will give you each some paper here so that if you do have a thought that you would like to share, you can take notes and share it after that person has finished talking. And then with that, I do ask that you also please direct your comments at me, as this is a learning experience for me. And also, it's a good way to avoid any potential arguing back and forth. Please also let me know if you need a break at any time, if you need to get up, stretch your legs, or if you need to get up and use the restroom. The restrooms are located to your right and down the hall. So at any time, you let me know, and we can do that. And is there any questions so far?
No.
Okay. And so do both of you understand and agree with the ground rules?
Yes.
All right. And are there any of your own ground rules that you would wish to add?
No.
Okay, great. All right. Well, then let's get started. Since Matt, you had asked for the mediation, I'll begin with you. And then once Matt is finished, Samantha, I will then give you the same opportunity. So is that okay with both of you?
Yes.
All right, good then. Okay, so Matt, if you can please begin by sharing your perspective on the situation.
Well, I just got this great job a few months ago, and I need a car. And right now, I don't have a, well, at the moment, I didn't have a car. But then my friend, Samantha, who's really good at fixing cars, and she tinkers with them a lot, she was selling a 5-year-old Camaro at the time. So I figured that, you know, any car that Samantha owned was going to be in really good shape. You know, I know she puts a lot of work into her cars, so if it, you know, that's a great car for me. And when I asked her about it, at first she didn't want to sell the car to a friend, but after kind of asking her a little bit more, finally, and telling her, you know, I need it for my job, she said okay, and she sold me the car for $1,500. And then after I paid her, I noticed she said to her dad that, well, now my headaches are gone. And I didn't think anything of it. But then after a week of driving in, I started to get headaches from the fumes that were filling the car. And then, so, you know, I brought it into Robert's garage, and they were saying that the exhaust system needs to be replaced, and this would cost $400. And then the mechanic also suggested that whoever sold me the car probably knew about this problem to begin with. So I kind of made me a little upset because Samantha never said anything about the exhaust system. She shared with me some other things that may have been wrong with the car, but she never said anything about the exhaust system. So after taking it to the garage, I called her up and asked for my money back. And at first she was fine with it. She said that she would return me the money and everything. But then the next day she called and she decided not to take the car back and said that it was my car now and I needed to release it. And I always thought of Samantha as a really good and close friend, but I feel like I've been taken advantage of since that we haven't spoken.
So Matt, if I understand correctly, so you had just got a job a few months ago, and then you didn't have a car, so you had went to Samantha, who was selling her Camaro, and you figured it would be in great shape, you needed it for your job, and so you had purchased it for $1,500. You had heard some comments about some headaches, but you started then receiving them yourself. Is all of that correct so far?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And so with the headaches, tell me a little bit more on when and how you noticed this occurring.
Well, within the first week, I started to understand what she meant. I started to get headaches from the fumes whenever I drove it, and then by that second week of driving it is when I brought it to the shop.
Okay, and when you had taken it to the shop, I did hear you mention that they had told you that it was an issue with the exhaust system, correct?
Yes.
Okay, and they were going to charge you $400?
Yeah.
To fix it, okay. And so did the mechanics say that it could have been anything else?
No, I mean, they said it was the exhaust and that the car will not. The car is considered a lemon right now, and it will not work until the exhaust is fixed.
Okay. All right, and then how did you approach that through Samantha?
Well, I mean, I just called her and said, you know, that I wanted my money back, that this car wasn't in good shape, that she sold me that, you know, it was a lemon. Like I said, at first she was fine with it and she was going to refund me the money, but then the next day she decided not to.
Well, going back to what you mentioned. mention about the car being a lemon. What do you mean by that?
I mean the, that's what the dealer said, but I, well, that's what the garage said, but I believe the definition of a lemon is for your car that just, it doesn't work.
Okay, so did they elaborate on what they meant by using the word lemon? I guess would have been a better way for me to ask for clarification. Okay. Okay, and then you had mentioned that you and Sam were good friends before. And so how do you view your relationship currently?
Well, so we haven't talked. I honestly feel tricked and cheated by Samantha. I mean, I would never think that friends would treat each other that way. And I mean, I really do feel cheated, and it kind of makes me think that Samantha doesn't care very much about me or our friendship.
And what makes you think that, Matt?
Just the fact that, you know, she would sell me a car that she knew didn't work. I don't think friends should treat each other that way. You know, also, I feel like I'm a good person who doesn't lie or cheat, and I don't see why that would, why she would want to do that to me. It almost seems as though she's laughing behind my back for buying a car from her.
Why do you think that she may be laughing at you?
Basically because of the comment that she made to her dad about that's a headache that I don't have for now, all my headaches are gone. So I mean, she obviously knew about the fumes in the car, and that's why it was giving her headaches. And so I feel like she kind of knew she was taking advantage of me a little bit because she knew more about cars than I did.
Okay, and have you tried to talk to Samantha about the situation?
Yeah, I mean, I called her right away, and I tried to do the decent thing and be upfront and honest with her about it. And at first I thought, you know, our relationship is great. She But then, you know, that next day when she said she wasn't going to refund the money, that's kind of when things took a turn.
Okay. So it does sound to me that you feel like you want your friendship to be valued a little more. And then also you feel, of course, that you're a good person. And you value that about yourself, and so your expectations are in maintaining that. Am I correct about that?
Yes.
Okay. So at this point, how do you feel that you would like to see this be handled?
Well, I need a car, so really either have this one be fixed or have my money refunded this way. Because I put all my money into this Camaro, where I don't have the money to pay for it to be fixed, so I either need it to be fixed or I need my money back.
Do you have anything else at this point to add?
No, that's it.
Okay. All right, well, thank you for sharing that. We'll now move on to Samantha, and I'd like to hear your perspectives on the situation.
Yes, I would just like to start off by saying that I like Matt, and I felt that I did the right thing and warned him ahead of time that I felt uncomfortable about selling this car to a friend in case anything happened. I genuinely did not know that this car would need the repair and become undrivable. I am 20 years old, I have been unemployed for 6 months. The only income I have is about $50 per week for doing odd jobs in the neighborhood. After I was laid off, I made the decision to sell this Camaro, and that's when Matt approached me about buying it. I was, as I said, reluctant to sell it. I always considered Matt one of my best friends, although I enjoy tinkering with cars and I'm pretty good at mechanics. This car had been a big headache for me, and from the moment I bought it, I feared that if anything went wrong with the car, it might hurt our friendship. Matt seemed extremely happy with the car on the day of the sale. But 2 weeks later, he did call me saying that it was undriveable because of the faulty exhaust system that would cost about $400 to repair. I did agree to exchange the car for his money back because I felt bad. I didn't want to expect this to happen. I didn't want to ruin our friendship. And I was sure the problems with the car could be fairly easily repaired. But then again, the next day, I did change my mind. I realized that it was going to be extremely difficult to refund Matt's purchase price since I had already spent the money that I had received. Besides, I did warn Chris that the car was not perfect at the time of the sale, and I just think it's unfair that I should be held responsible for defects that arose after I sold the car to Matt.
Okay, Samantha, so thank you. With that being said, you said that you had warned him ahead of time. So what types of things was it that you had warned him about?
I did not know about this faulty exhaust system. I warned him that I felt uncomfortable selling it to a friend because I was concerned that it would hurt our friendship.
Okay, so to explain to me, please, why you felt that it would hurt your friendship selling him this car.
Just in the fact that if anything did happen, I didn't want to be blamed like it's happening now.
Okay, so tell me a little bit more. You had also mentioned about your relationship with Matt being a good one, that he was a good friend, and that you did, of course, fear that something, you know, if something did occur with the car, that he would be mad. Am I correct in saying that?
Yes.
Okay, so tell me a little bit more, though, about your friendship and, you know, why you thought maybe that the car would, come between that.
Because we know each other from the sale, and it's easy to contact the person that you bought it from, because I am a closer friend rather than a stranger who's just selling the car, I was nervous that if anything happened at all, it would automatically be my fault, and I just didn't want that to come back to me. Like right now, Matt is making me feel like I cheated him somehow, and I don't want anybody to.
So it sounds to me like you also value the friendship that you all have, and also that you feel like you want to be respected in the sense of not being maybe accused of anything that might have occurred with the vehicle. Am I correct in saying that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, is there anything else that you want to add about the situation with the car? Or the friendship?
I do feel bad still, but I don't have any money to give because of my situation. The money that he gave to me right away went to rent, food, tuition, and utilities. I don't have it. And
yep. So how is it that you feel you would like to see this situation, or what you would like to see out of this situation?
I wanted to find a way to settle this issue anyway. That's why I'm here, because I'm kind of kind of regret selling it to him because I didn't want this to come up at all in any situation. And I'm concerned that this has hurt the friendship between the two of us. It seems unfair.
Okay. Well, thank you for sharing. Did you have anything else to add to any of the things that we just currently discussed?
I would guess I have just a statement that I do consider myself to be a straightforward person. That's why I didn't want to sell the car to Matt. And I told him that. However, I did cut off all communication when he requested his money back.
So please explain to me what you mean by cut off all communication.
Just no more texting or calling. I didn't take until I read that he set up mediation for us.
So just to make sure that I have gathered all of your information correctly, so it does sound like you had a vehicle that was for sale, and Matt had came to you asking about it, that you had warned him ahead of time. You did not know ahead of time that the car was undrivable, yet you did feel uncomfortable because in this case of anything would happen with it. You felt uncomfortable, you know, selling it to a friend. But you, because you were laid off, you did decide to sell it, even though you were reluctant, correct?
Yes.
Is that correct so far? Okay. Well, thank you again for sharing. Is there anything else that maybe I have missed in what you were telling me?
I'm just interested in maintaining my honest reputation as well.
Okay. Thank you again. And so Matt, going back to you, is there anything that you feel after hearing her perspectives that you would like to share?
Well, I really appreciate how many times she said that she, she appreciates our friendship and considers me a good friend. And I mean, that's really it. I guess it's possible that I took the whole headache comment the wrong way. But I also, that doesn't fix the problem that she sold me a bad car and I need a car.
Okay. Is there anything else that you would like to add to that?
No.
Okay. So Samantha, going back to you, is there anything else that you would like to share?
No.
Perspectives. Okay, so to me, in speaking with both of you, some commonalities that I definitely have found that I think is definitely important to the both of you is your relationship. So it does appear that both of you value your relationship. You have been friends for a while. So you would like to see some of that potentially get repaired. Am I correct in that?
Yes.
Okay. Great. And I just want to commend you all so far that you all have been doing great, and this is a really good way to discuss issues and get some perspectives out on the table. Also, though, I did notice that there were some other key issues. I would like for us to be able to set up an agenda in trying to discover and, you know, come up with some mutual agreements on things that we need to discuss and work on. Okay, so we did say that relationship was definitely one of them. And then to me, it also seems as if the vehicle itself, of course, is another one. Am I correct in saying that?
Yes.
Okay, so for agenda setting, I'm just going to get the relationship we said. Okay, so those are just two ideas that we have jotted down. What I want to write over here It's going to be some criteria of different things that we want to make sure are mutual in each of the items that we talk about on the agenda. So it's going to be decisions once we get there that are going to be achievable. And this, of course, is just, it's a little bit after this, but I just want to write them over here so that we can make sure that we're kind of keeping an eye on that throughout writing items up there. So achievable, fair, practical, mutual gain. Okay, so other than the relationship and the vehicle, what else do you all feel is important for us to discuss? Some things that both of you mutually want to see.
I my reputation, I need to be honest. I have an honest reputation now, and I don't want that to be any hindrance on it because of this process.
Okay, so reputation. Now, Matt, what do you feel about that? Is that something else that you also are concerned with, or is it more?
Yeah, I mean, I could tie in, you know, how I feel as though I was taking advantage of, like, that could go into reputation.
Got it. Okay, and keep in mind, each of these we will really dig into a little more. So this is great, you know, just getting it out as an agenda here to discuss some things. So with that, are there some other things that we feel we can agree upon today that we need to further discuss and dig into?
Well, I mean, we'll need to talk about the money, but I don't know if that should fall under vehicle or not.
And that's fine. We can do that as we further dig into it, do some brainstorming. Anything else?
I think that's all.
Okay, so it does appear that both of you do want to dig a little deeper in trying to see what we can resolve in the relationship. Of course, the vehicle itself, to include the money, and then also reputations, perhaps expectations of how you feel that you want to be treated by one each other. Okay, great. So let's go ahead and we're going to go into the brainstorming stage. So each of these are great ideas. I think they're great commonalities that we need to discuss. And let's see if this marker, I apologize, the marker's here. Okay, so let's start with, figure out which one we would like to start with first. I would like for you all to
kind of take a look at the relationship.
That's what I was going
to say. Okay, relationship. So you all both feel that relationship's the most important to at least discuss first, correct?
There's only a couple minutes left. They close down at 9 o'clock.
She's not.
Yeah, she's at 27 minutes.
So we're going to have to take, I can't do anything about it. The studio closes at 9 o'clock. We'll have to take you over and finish up over